Welcome again once more to Hocking Hills United Methodist Church, and I invite you now to pray with me as we start our service. Oh Lord, we thank you for this day, and we call upon your precious name this morning as we enter into this fourth week of Advent, anticipating again in this season the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ, who has come to save. And so, Father, as we center our hearts here this morning and remove all distractions from worship, we anticipate your Spirit falling afresh on us this morning. Bless us, Lord, as we worship here together, or if we're worshiping from home online, reach each one where they need to be reached this day. We pray these things in the precious name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite Roland now to come as we share our Advent meditation together.
Is his mic on?
Back to the phone.
You want to play with my pants?
Okay. We are in church, you know.
We are in church. I didn't realize how exciting church was going to get this morning. All right, our scripture reading today and our Advent study comes from the Old Testament reading and a New Testament reading, Micah chapter 5. I'll read verse 2 through 5. But you, Bethlehem Ephratah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me, one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times. Therefore Israel will be abandoned until the time when she who is in labor gives birth, and the rest of his brothers return to join the Israelites. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they will live securely. For then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth, and he will be their peace. And we are reminded in the Gospel of Luke, Mary's visit to Elizabeth. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." May the Lord have his blessing upon the reading of his word today.
Sometimes when we are trying something new, or when we're facing a difficult decision, or when we want to celebrate something, or maybe when we just feel lost and alone or uncertain about life or the universe or everything, we need a blessing. We don't always think of it that way, or we may not always word it in that type of fashion, but we need advice or support or a companion or someone just to come along beside us and lift us up once more so that we can see something besides the tops of our shoes. We seek a blessing.
For many of us, we go home. We ask mom, we talk to dad or a brother, a sister, a close friend, those we grew up with, those who know us best. We want them alongside. We want to be in their presence. Somehow, we know that being there, being home, will make all things better. Maybe it won't get fixed, or it won't be solved, or wished away, but at least we will not be alone. So we seek a blessing.
Mary, faced with an incomprehensible burden and a gift, she ran to her cousin Elizabeth's house, looking for someone who knew a little bit about what she was going through. She was looking for a place to hide until the reality of her condition could be something made real. And she received a blessing. The prophet Micah spoke of a blessing coming in an unexpected place, in an unassuming town, yet by God's grace would become the means for which God would bless the whole world. Bethlehem, a little town of great blessing. We seek a blessing.
So we've lit these candles, the candle of hope, candle of peace, the candle of joy, and now today we have lit the candle of love. These candles are a sign that we know blessing, and we know waiting for blessing to be felt and lived is worth it. So we have lit these candles as a sign that we are going to still seek a blessing. It's time to focus on home, to focus on our salvation in a little town called Bethlehem.
Let us pray together. Lord, we come home to you. Lord, search our hearts. Let us find a great blessing, Lord, in peace, in your rest and comfort, and in this town of Bethlehem that we have journeyed through this Advent season. Father, we thank you for this grace and this blessing that you have given to us. Lord, continue to be with us as we walk these streets of Bethlehem seeking our blessing. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Friends, enjoy our prelude this morning.
Two for three, I guess, this morning. I can fix it myself. Welcome to a very festive worship service already this morning here at Hocking Hills United Methodist Church. I am Ryan Weitzcarver. I am your music director. Please stand with me and sing with me and joining, whatever, let's sing together.
Oh,
You, if you have your Bible with you today, to join me in the book of Luke, chapter 2. We'll be going through verses 8 through 20 today, and although this is a very familiar passage, I invite you to hear it with fresh and new ears this morning. So hear these words today. And there were shepherds living in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those for whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them on her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they were told. May God's blessing be on his word today.
Thank you, Pastor Charlene, for sharing a very familiar scripture passage. And I'm going to take a fresh look at this passage today with the continuation of this series that we've titled Bethlehem's Fame. What made this little town so famous? What put it on the map? Well, several things began to happen around Mary and Joseph's arrival into Bethlehem as they journeyed from Nazareth, Mary very pregnant, and now it came time for her to have the baby Jesus. And we think about what transpired, the events that came. One of the things we learn is that through this passage, we learn what the chief end of man is. You were created with a goal in mind to bring God honor and glory. Have you heard that it's the answer to the question, what is the ultimate goal of mankind? Well, the chief end of mankind is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. This is the message of the angels praising. This is the message of peace on earth. While this is not a phrase drawn directly from Scripture, the wisdom behind it surely is. As we have learned throughout church history, The Bible tells us with a great clarity that we were created in order to bring glory to God. Thus, the chief end of the Christian and of the church is to praise God, honor Him, and bring Him glory. And what a better way to do that than through our worship of Him. That's why we've gathered here today. I know you want a cookie when you leave, but here we are thinking about worship happening through our prayers, our offerings, the word that we have heard and now is being proclaimed and taught. We sing hymns and we praise God with songs, and you're going to hear a song by the choir in just a moment that will just bless you. What was the last concert you attended? Can you think back? Well, wherever or whatever it was, I bet it involved music. You know, I think the last big concert I attended was Winter Jam, where a bunch of Christian groups gather in Columbus, and you pay one fee, and you get to hear almost 10 bands. Went with the youth group one year. But most recently, the concert I attended was my son's Christmas music program concert. When I think of concerts during the Advent season, I think back and I can recall one particular concert that I attended that I'll never forget. It was a singing Christmas tree. No, not an actual tree that started singing. That would be something you would never forget, wouldn't it? But it was more of a choir that sung a Christmas cantata in the shape of a Christmas tree. Literally, the choir was strategically placed on platforms that were built in the shape of a Christmas tree, and they filled it to the top with a star on top, and it really looked like a Christmas tree. And they called it the Singing Christmas Tree. That was a very memorable concert that I'll never forget. Now, I'm sure those people up at the top were reminded that they should bend their knees and not lose faint. So we are told that on the night of Jesus' birth, there was this spontaneous breakout worship service that turned into a concert that was performed to some lowly shepherds tending their flocks at night. Something those shepherds would never forget, I'm sure. A heavenly choir breaking out in worship. Angelic voices praising God. The message behind their praise was peace on earth. Now, this angelic choir gives us an example of what our ultimate end is: to praise our Heavenly Father, for He is good, He's loving, and He's forgiving. He's sending His only Son as this ultimate sacrifice, a gift for our salvation. So as we look at this text, as we try to imagine what the shepherds experienced on the outskirts of Bethlehem, the angels' message, and then a host of heavenly angels forming a praise service, is there any praise in you for the Christmas gift of God's Son? Well, let's look at this heavenly concert. One of the things that we noticed is that this put Bethlehem on the map. The reason why it put Bethlehem on the map is because those who attended this concert shared it. I've often struggled with why in the world the angels debuted a heavenly concert to some very poor shepherds on the outskirts of town of Bethlehem. Why would God not have such a big and grand news be celebrated to the world for more people to witness? Why didn't He reserve the biggest amphitheater in the biggest city for this concert of heavenly proportions? Why would God not announce His Son's birth to the political and the religious leaders of that day? And rather, He would choose just a few humble shepherds. Well, the biggest reason involves why Bethlehem became famous. This infant lowly in a manger lay was to be the Messiah for all people, not just for the elites of the world. Jesus was ultimately this sacrificial lamb like those being cared for by these shepherds. Now, the shepherds were responsible for making sure that all of these newborn lambs would have no defects, since the sacrificial animals had to be without blemish or defect when they would go into the temple area and be used for the sacrificial system that was created by the law of Moses in the Old Testament, still very well in production and practice in the day that Jesus was born. Now, I noticed that as I've learned about shepherding and sheep, one of the actions that these shepherds would have taken was to tightly wrap the lambs in cloth to keep them from becoming blemished or injuring themselves. So when I think about this and I hear how Luke tells us that Jesus was wrapped in cloths and laid in a manger, it brings my awareness to why Luke is telling us Jesus was wrapped tightly in this cloth, because at his birth, this symbolic thing would be very real to the shepherds, as this birth was the sinless Lamb of God whose substitutionary sacrifice would take away the sins of the world. Peace on earth wasn't about the tranquility, but it was about God bringing an end to the hostility between he and man because of our sin. The angels praise God and they declare peace on earth to the people he favors, a reference to all those who were going to submit themselves to the Messiah, Savior, and Lord of their life. So this angelic announcement was peace on earth. And we hear so much about peace on earth during Advent. But it's not about a quiet tranquility or merely just the absence of animosity between people. No, it's a declaration of a coming end of hostilities between a holy God and a sinful humanity through the atoning work of Jesus, who would be our Savior. So only when we accept Jesus as our Savior, by confessing with our mouths that we are sinners, and believing in our hearts that he is our Lord, are we seen as righteous in God's eyes. So Paul tells us in the book of Romans, he says, therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace. There's the word peace. That's the word the angels used when they were declaring this to the shepherds. Peace on whom his favor rests. Peace with who? Peace with God through who? Our Lord Jesus Christ. So you think about that. I think about that today, and I think about the shepherds out in the fields. I hope maybe you have had the chance to use one of the copies of gifts we've given you for Advent. There's still a few of these on the guest table in the back, and I hope that maybe you have used this as part of your devotional reading this Advent season. I kind of stumbled across December 6th reading on that day. It caught my attention as I thought about these shepherds, as I thought about looking at this text again. And one of the things that was brought out to me was this devotional by Gina Bridgman, as she talked about how on the night of Jesus' birth, trying to imagine the shepherds watching their flocks with a single-minded devotion, and once night fell upon them, their job became their soul focus. It was that singular focus that caught my attention, because that's quite different from our multitasking life we live in today. We watch our children, our grandchildren's Christmas concerts and programs. We watch for the sales of gifts on our list. We watch for the annual productions of our Christmas plays. We attend our share of Christmas parties and events, and we watch for the TV specials. Then we watch for our church services, our church events, maybe a movie or two. I mean, after all, it wouldn't be Christmas for me without It's a Wonderful Life, starring Jimmy Stewart. So we think about it. Watching all of this makes for one busy season, but it doesn't really keep that singular focus on Jesus. Gina goes on to say that even our church events, our church concerts, our church shows, while they carry the message of Jesus' birth, it can be distracting from you focusing on Christ himself, on just Jesus. Because after all, it all started with a little baby in a manger. That reminds me of a time in my own life when I was forced away from all the busyness of the Christmas season. And I'm walking out of my tent on Christmas Eve, after having a great dinner with a few other soldiers with General Colin Powell. It was later that evening, after reading a letter from home, that I walked out of my tent, out into that desert night sky, looked up into that firmament of that starry night, and I felt that connection to that first Christmas. And it allowed me to focus my heart on the one who was at the center of it all. Now, the prophet Isaiah reminds us that we are a people who are walking in darkness, but we have seen this great light. And this light has dawned on those living in the land of darkness. Now, we live in a time when we have light continually, unless the power goes out. And then it's dark. And we have generators that will bring our light back on. And so when we think about when the time of the prophet Isaiah's writing of this, we think about the time that the shepherds were tending their flocks by night. There were no great city lights. There were no lights on posts anywhere. It was complete and utter darkness. So when you hear of how the people who are walking in darkness, a light has dawned, even the small flicker of a light makes an impact on that kind of darkness. Jesus, you are the bright and morning star. Lead me to make you the center of every Christmas season. This should become our singular focus. I've often wondered what Christmas would be like for all of us if we were to strip away everything that we use as traditional. We were to take away the plants. We were to take away the instruments. We were to take away the lighting. We were to take and strip everything away, and all we would have would be a little manger with a little baby in it. What would we be able to accomplish in that kind of a Christmas season? Well, one of the things that I also notice about these shepherds is that they shared the gift. The shepherds didn't stay out on the outskirts of town and keep all this to themselves. The Bible tells us they excitedly hurried into Bethlehem. There they found Joseph and Mary. There the baby, wrapped in cloth, lying in a manger, just like the angel had told them. There they worshiped, and then they began to share this news with everybody they could. And their sharing of this brought fame to Bethlehem. If it wasn't for their testimony, Bethlehem would not have marveled at all they were sharing, as the scriptures are telling us. I think what we've done with Christmas is, I think we've made it one of the most complicated seasons of the year, even above Easter. And when we are distracted from the singular focus, and when we remove Jesus from Christmas, it's like planning and attending a birthday party and not inviting the person whose birthday we plan to attend and celebrate. In other words, when we remove Jesus Christ from Christmas, we have nothing but a secular celebration. The lesson from the shepherds is that we are to worship the baby, and then we are to tell everybody we see about the baby Jesus. We are to keep Christ as the priority in our Christmas. I was sharing yesterday with the people who attended our tea event. Currently, I'm reading a book by Philip Keller called Lessons from a Sheepdog. And he describes in this book how he stumbled across an ad in the paper and he saw free border collie for a good loving home. And the course, when he inquired about the dog, it was still available, of course. And Philip Keller, at the time in his mid-20s, had just bought a sheep ranch. And, of course, by himself and his wife, they alone could not contain and care for all of these sheep and this ranch. And he thought to himself, if I could just get one good sheep dog, then that sheep dog and I could do the work of five men. One good border collie sheepdog. Well, he arrived at the owner's location, and Keller writes that he noticed that the dog was was chained up outside, around its neck, around its hind leg, and it was infested with fleas and ticks, and its hair was mangled and it was dirty, and as he approached it, it began to snarl at him and growl at him. And so he thought, well, the old dog was 2 years old, the owner said. So Keller thought, well, he's probably gone wrong and was totally useless, the owner implied. And 2 years, Keller thought, well, the dog probably can't be trained. But something inside of Keller told him to take the dog. He hated to see this dog put down. As he looked at the physical attributes of the dog, it was a fine specimen of a border collie that had been purebred and trained and raised to do a specific job. And so he finally managed to get the dog in the back of the seat of his car, and on the long ride back to the country at his farm, periodically he would reach around and attempt to touch and pet the dog, but the dog would growl and snap at him. Upon arriving home, he finally managed to get the dog out, put her into the place that he'd fixed up. He and his wife had built a very fine kennel, clean bedding, a large bowl of water, and a dish of food heaped on it. But the dog ignored everything. She refused to eat the food, drink the fresh water, and even enter into this brand new kennel. Any attempts to pet the dog or touch her were rejected. Any attempts that they would speak kindly to her were met with low growls and bared fangs. Keller finally at a loss. The dog wasn't eating or drinking. Keller decided at a last ditch effort to keep the dog from wasting away, he was going to have to turn her loose. And off she darted like a deer to the woods behind the house. And Keller wondered if he'd ever see this dog again. In fact, several weeks went by before Keller would actually see the dog. He had almost given up on the dog. Then one evening, as he was moving some sheep from one pasture to another, he looked up and saw her crouched down on the rock above the pasture. She was watching very intently every move of the shepherd and the sheep. Her instincts were beginning to kick back in, and she was being drawn in by the shepherd and how he shepherded the sheep. And he noticed as a few weeks went by, she would get closer to him in the evenings and sat on the edge of the pasture watching this sheep. When he would see her, he would flip some food and he'd leave some water and he'd speak those kind words to her. But during her trek to get the food, Keller would also speak very clearly. And he wondered if the dog was ever going to come around. The time came close because he had told the owner, I'll give the dog 6 weeks. And after 6 weeks, if the dog doesn't come around, we're going to have to put her down. On the last week, Keller didn't want to put the dog down. And he prayed and he thought about such a fine dog. And so finally one evening, as he was taking the sheep up into the pasture, looked out at the sea off the coast, had his hands behind his back, he felt a nudge, a warm touch. It was Lass, the sheepdog. She had finally made the decision to trust the shepherd. I think the times are too many that I can count that I have seen broken people come into the church, pressed by their problems. They're chained around their necks and their feet. They have been constricted, and they can hardly function or walk. I've also noticed, though, that in time, if they've kept coming, the grace of God gently works on their spirit, whether it was their praying that they heard, or the singing that they heard, or the gentle moving of the Spirit, or maybe the power of God's word being proclaimed, or the fellowship of the church. All of it was beginning to work together to turn their life around. And this is what takes place when the voice of the shepherd reaches through to those who are willing to heed that voice. Why did God pick shepherds to share this news? Because he knew that his son would be the good shepherd that would lead the flock home. The shepherds heard the words and the angels, and they responded, the Bible says, with great joy and hope. When you read in the beginning, if they had pants, they would have peed their pants. They were toes terrified. But in the end, they go back, and their life was changed forever. And they were full of joy and excitement. And the angels sang, "Why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong? Why this gladsome tidings be, which inspire your heavenly song? Gloria in excelsis Deo." What that means is glory to God in the highest. This video of angels we have heard on high will hopefully inspire you and bring you that same excitement and joy in the message the shepherds heard and shared on that night of Jesus' birth. And so why do we celebrate this Advent season? Why do we dress our children up as shepherds and wise men and angels? Why do we have a Mary and a Joseph? We have all of this because in a little town called Bethlehem, a few little lowly shepherds out in the field got the concert of a lifetime. And they ran into this town and worshiped the baby and went out and shared with everybody that they could the events that unfolded. Share the gift. Share how it's impacted your life. Share your gifts through his gift to you. Share the hope. Share our church. Share the love of God from a little town called Bethlehem. Let's pray. Father God, as we prepare for this hymn of prayer, may we reflect upon the words of the angel to these lowly shepherds. May we reflect upon this heavenly concert, the message that the angels proclaim to us through the birth of our Savior, as well their worship of you. Glory to God in the highest. May this be the center of all that we focus on. Thank you, Lord, for your gift. Thank you for Bethlehem, because it's through this little town we find our salvation. In your name we pray. Amen.
Almighty Father, today, Lord, let us, like the shepherds, go and seek the King. Wherever our hearts are stationed, and in this Advent season, Lord, give us the encouragement to look at this precious face, the true gift in the manger bed. Father, that is certainly where we find our blessing. That is where our blessing lays. That is where you have given us hope. And that is where you have given us and divinely revealed your love. Lord, let us take cue from the angels and to go and to tell, not just at Christmas time, but in all seasons and in each day and in every year. And so, Lord, while we bask in your blessing, we uplift the many names on our heart today that need a great blessing too. So, Father, we just ask that you would hear those concerns upon our heart and those we write on our prayer cards, and, Lord, those names we cry out to you. Father, may you hear the voices of our praise, and we ask these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
sell the news, right?
So before you leave, we have a few items that if you haven't had the chance to grab, this one we handed out during Commitment Sunday, and we have some more. So the goal for you is to grab some of these and pass them out as an invitation to tell the news of our Christmas Eve service, which will be held where? Well, you guys got it, all right. Middle school at 7 o'clock is our special Christmas cantata. The choir has been working really hard. They're really excited to celebrate Jesus' birth through this message of Bethlehem. And then we're going to be worshiping there that Sunday on the 26th. So at the middle school, Christmas Eve, and then worship there Sunday. The possibility that we will worship there the following Sunday, which is the first Sunday in January. Now, keep your prayers going. By the second Sunday of January, if everything passes inspection this week and the next, we will be worshiping in our new church. So just keep that up. Keep that mindful. So this could be our last Sunday here at the Senior Center. So be praying about that. Now, as I share with you that, when we get into our building, although we'll be able to get into the building and worship, it won't all be done quite yet. There'll still be some other things that will need to be done and attended to. But we're close. We're so close. We also have this little paper that you can take. We got some copies. We passed this out last night at the tea event, which was a totally awesome event. About 50 people attended. I learned a lot about tea. And I did not know you weren't supposed to put your pinky out when you drank tea. I always thought you did that, but you don't do that, right? So it was a wonderful event. Music and the servers, everybody made it a wonderful event. So there's cookies as you leave on that table in the back that you can have to grab some cookies. There's also still some of these extra devotional copies on the back there. So just a heads up on those things. Also, we still have, if you didn't get one, a handheld wooden cross that we are giving away for Christmas. This is wood cut from trees, wood out of Bethlehem in the Holy Land. So it also comes with a little card and a bookmarker that you can have. So we have, if you didn't get one, if you want to take one to somebody, give it to them, you can do that as well. So also, there's a sign-up sheet for trustee teams. So we're looking for trustee teams. You don't